Welcome, and I hope you're having a great day, to the Pomerantz Mentor Series, sponsored by PROSCAN Imaging Education Foundation. And today's vignette is going to continue along a trend of sequences used in the wrist where we highlight some of the more difficult issues and unique issues related to imaging the wrist utilizing magnetic resonance imaging. Let's start out with this triple image. Where on the left side, you see an MR arthrogram where contrast has been placed into the radioscaphoid articulation, just as it would be with any conventional arthrographic technique. As you may or may not know, you can inject any one of three compartments, but this is the most typical compartment injected. And when we're looking at the intrinsic ligaments, we look for extravasation through the scapholunate, or off the screen, the lunato-triquetral interval into the mid-carpal space. The T1-weighted image in the middle, the so-called fat-weighted image without contrast, shows marked widening of the scapholunate interval and the somewhat triangular shape of the scapholunate ligament. We've discussed in the past that the scapholunate ligament, depending upon whether you're ventral, dorsal, or in the membranous midsection, can be triangular, it can be bar or linear shape, or even trapezoidal shape. And it's certainly most strong along the dorsal aspect of the wrist. It's clear, even on the T1 non-arthrographic image, that there is marked widening of this interval. And what's it filled with? It's filled with synovial inflammation and granulation tissue. You can sometimes augment this widening by doing either radial or ulnar deviation or clenched fist view imaging. In no way did you really need the arthrogram to document the extravasation of contrast lurching through the scaphoid side of the scapholunate ligament. The T1 weighted image itself shows that. We'll talk a little bit more about when to inject and when not to inject in a few moments. The proton density spur, or the heavily water weighted sequence, demonstrates the same phenomenon. For you non-MR practitioners and clinicians out there, don't worry too much about the names of these sequences. All you need to know is this one is fat weighted. So the fat is white in the bone marrow. The signal of the tissue in the joint is going to be gray to dark. Whereas on a fat suppressed sequence, where the fat, such as the bone marrow fat, is very, very dark, you have extreme sensitivity. And you look at it more or less like you'd look at a bone scan. You're looking for bright areas or hot spots, like this one, or this one, which is synovial inflammation or fluid along the margin of the scaphoid. Now, many of you will order contrast-enhanced MRIs of the wrist. And the main indication for contrast MRI of the wrist is the clinician just wants it. It's pretty expensive to do. Bear in mind that a vial of contrast, a full vial, can cost between $50 and $100 added to the examination. The overwhelming majority of cases, well over 95% of scapholunate instabilities, are diagnosed without putting contrast in the joint in expert hands. The joint that's a little bit tougher, with only 85% accuracy, is the lunato-triquetral interval. So if we have a patient with ulnar-sided wrist pain and we haven't discovered the cause, or we're suspicious of a lunato-triquetral ligament injury and we don't see it, that is where we'll perform an MR arthrogram. Now let's take a look at this Bloomin onion, or the phenomenon of blooming, also known as susceptibility effect. I have presented before you three different sequences. The PD spur, or said another way, the fat-suppressed, water-emphasized image, the more or less bone scan type image. This time we have a mass that is not uniformly bright, but rather mixed in signal, more bright in the center, a little less bright around the outside. The adjacent fat-weighted image shows our mass with intermediate signal intensity located just proximal to the pisiform on these coronal sequences. This triple image slide is meant to highlight the gradient echo sequence, which is used to detect blood, hemosiderin, cartilage, and the cartilage is going to be white, so it's an intra-articular sequence, but it also has the advantage of detecting tissues of unusual and different susceptibilities. Now, what is susceptibility? It's the willingness and ability of a tissue to be magnetized. What tissue is going to be more magnetized than tissue that contains iron? So when you have iron-containing substances such as blood or blood breakdown products, they show up on these susceptibility-sensitive sequences. In fact, we've even come up with susceptibility-weighted imaging, a special and unique sequence. This one, though, is a standard graded echo sequence that can be performed on any low, mid, or high field scanner. It's called a gradient echo because it's water emphasized. It's sometimes called a T2 star or T2 emphasized or water emphasized gradient echo, which means you can also make a fat emphasized gradient echo. On the water emphasized gradient echo, the water and the hyaline cartilage will be white, but siderotic containing tissues, such as this one, will have hypointensity, a tip-off to the primary diagnosis. Here we are in the short axis view, and we're demonstrating the three sequences, T1 or fat-weighted, contrast-enhanced T1, and the standard T2 Fastman echo sequence. We're also demonstrating the short axis projection. Now, the short axis projection is often used to augment the long axis projections, especially when you're looking for tunnel syndromes and you want to localize where a lesion is, since it's a very familiar sequence to all of us, even clinicians, since we've been looking at CAT scans for so many years. We've already articulated that the fat-weighted sequence shows the endosteal and medullary bone is bright. It also has the benefit of high specificity for certain disease processes like fractures and osteomyelitis. But it's not nearly as sensitive as the fat-suppressed sequence, the PD spur. Now the T2, this is also a water-weighted sequence. But relative to the PD spur, where the marrow was very, very black, the marrow is, it's not so black. Therefore, the sensitivity of this sequence is not as high for detecting any shifts in water. In other words, it doesn't have a bone scan or soft tissue scan-like quality. At the same time, areas of pure water, such as this small dorsally extending effusion, will show up. But areas of mixed water content, areas of proteinaceous water, may have variable signal intensity. The T2 weighted image is a cleanup sequence. It does very well with ligaments and tendons, and especially with acute injuries, sorting out the different signal intensities. But it suffers from relative lack of sensitivity. Now, in our patient who has a siderotic containing mass, the overall appearance of the mass on the T2 weighted image is one of dark signal intensity, which represents a combination of blood, siderosis, and especially fibrous tissue and fibroinflammatory change. The contrast image. When would you put contrast in an IV and inject it into the arm as opposed to placing it into the joint? When you have an atypical mass in a position that looks like it might be benign, but its signal characteristics are intermediate or indeterminate. Or conversely, you have a mass with very classic signal characteristics, say for a ganglion pseudocyst, but it's in a very unusual place. In other words, you're not absolutely sure whether it's non-aggressive or aggressive. And this is going to be the overwhelming minority of cases. Did we need to put contrast in this case to show mild enhancement of our lesion? Not at all. The lesion had total specificity for the diagnosis of pigmented villonodular synovitis, also known as localized giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. These masses can be a little infiltrative, as was determined on the pathology. They can thicken the synovium of the entire joint. They're nodular. They're often sharp-edged. They may be embedded in a collagenous pseudocapsule that is often hemosiderin-laden, such as the one already shown in the gradient echo sequence. Now another sequence that is incredibly valuable in the wrist and available on some of the newer scanners is the steady state free precession. All you really need to know right now is that this is a very signal-rich sequence that allows for extremely thin sections, 1.2, 1.0, 0.8 millimeters. It can be combined with three-dimensional SLAM imaging that allows you to rotate the image in any plane. It has very good signal and contrast characteristics. It's often performed on high-field systems. This particular one is displayed with a small field of view with approximately 1 millimeter slices, and contrast has been placed into the joint, demonstrating detachment of the peripheral and distal attachments of the triangulofibrocartilage. One can see the scapholunate ligament, the fenestrated lunatotriquetral ligament, the attachment to the radial cartilage of the triangulofibrocartilage, and the attachments that would normally be present out here peripherally are gone. They're ruptured. These small synechiae or laminar or linear-like structures represent a combination of the ulno meniscus homolog and some areas of scar formation and distal attachments of the TFC which are ruptured, one being the lateral lunate ligament or the triquetral attachment of the TFC. Here's another example of pulsing sequences, this time reverting back to the short axis projection. Remember, we use this for localization to get comfortable with the position of masses. In this case, our mass is on the radial side. We have a T2-weighted image, which is a refining sequence. Now, for you clinicians out there, the regular T2-weighted image without fat suppression. And how do you know there's no fat suppression? Look at the bone marrow. The bone marrow is duller than the T1 fat-weighted image, but not black, as in a heavily fat suppression sequence. So it's not bone scan-like. It's not highly sensitive for shifts in water. But when there's large aggregates of water, when there's high cytoplasmic to nuclear ratio, the signal is going to be white. So cysts, ganglion pseudocysts, cancers that have tremendous cytoplasm, they'll be bright on the T2-weighted image. But solid lesions, lymphoma, tumors that don't have a lot of cytoplasm, they're going to be gray, intermediate, on the T2-weighted image. This particular one is a ganglion pseudocyst. It has a little tail headed towards the joint. But that's not the point of these short-axis, fat, and mildly water-weighted images. It's for localization. And what we can see is the flexor carpi radialis lying just palmar to our mass. But the mass has splayed the radial artery over to the side. So it's located between a portion of the radial artery and the flexor carpi radialis. Important information for the clinician should they go in and try and remove this lesion, which is likely. Now the sagittal view. It's kind of the stepdaughter, the stepmother, the stepsister, the stepbrother. It's not the primary sequence in wrist imaging, but anytime you have pathology that rides along a long structure, like a tendon. Tendons run all the way from the elbow down to the wrist, and you want to see length, or you want to see retraction, or you want to see alignment. Then you resort to the sagittal projection. This particular one shows an area of induration and inflammation and cellulitis on the water-emphasized T2-weighted image, although it's not fat-suppressed. So the true extent of edema is not as well seen as if you fat-suppressed on a PD spur, and the skin thickening and induration and infiltration of the fat is apparent on the T1-weighted image. So this concludes our discussion of sequence highlights. We've focused on alternating between the coronal and the axial. We've taken you through the heavily fat-suppressed PD spur sequence where water signal intensity is highlighted on virtually every abnormality. It's used a little bit like a bone scan in that you're looking for an abnormality that's bright in the soft tissues or bone. Once you find it, then you go to your fat-weighted image. Then you go to your more specific but less sensitive T2 weighted image, and you proceed to analyze further. Finally, we also talked about the water-emphasized gradient echo image, which has the unique feature of highlighting tissues with different susceptibility. And that includes tissues that contain iron or siderotic blood breakdown products. Thanks, and have a great day.